Okay, thank you very much, Kenneth, for a nice introduction. So my name is Yusaku Horiuchi. I'm associate professor at Dartmouth College. And thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to present this relatively new paper, which I'm co-authoring with two junior scholars, smart scholars, Mike Beckley at Tufts University. He's a scholar of international relations. And also Jenny Miller, she's also at Dartmouth, and she's a historian. And I've been working with so many people for many different projects, but this is my very first time to work with a historian, and I'm really enjoying working on this particular project. So the topic is Japan's post-war economic growth. That is a topic that has been widely studied by economists, political scientists, and historians for many decades. But we provide new evidence that supports an untested claim that Japan's growth depended on Japan's close relationship with the United States. So the post-war rise of Japan is one of the most dramatic cases of rapid economic development in modern history. And a decade after losing the war, and also one third of its industrial infrastructure along with the war, Japan returned to pre-war level of productivity, wealth, and consumption relatively quickly. But what is more remarkable in the context of Japan is that Japan's economic growth rate actually accelerated after this recovery period. So from the late 1950s to the early 1970s, Japan's economy grew on average more than 10% annually. And by 1970, Japan became the third largest economy in the world and ranked among the most developed countries in the world. So our big question is, why did Japan's growth rate accelerate? And a related important question is, when more exactly the growth acceleration started? So as I briefly mentioned at the beginning, so many political scientists, economists, and historians have examined this particular question. And many different studies focus on many different aspects, but many of them credit Japan's success to its domestic factors. So specifically, they tell something like the following. In the mid-1950s, a coalition of Japanese bureaucrats and business people set Japan on a path of rapid economic growth through aggressive export promotion and a technology acquisition from foreign countries, careful restrictions of inward foreign direct investment and commodity imports to Japan, and well-designed industrial policies. And as a result of these policies, as well as some other favorable initial conditions, rapid growth took off in Japan. Okay? But on the other hand, a relatively small group of studies suggest that this conventional wisdom focusing on domestic factors is correct, but not complete. And they argue that Japan's growth, economic growth, also depended on international environment. And in other words, Japanese domestic policies were partially endogenous to the international environment. More specifically, for example, high investment rates in Japan required an abundant capital from other countries, and export-oriented growth definitely require willing buyers, and also the technology acquisition and protectionist policies necessitated a tolerant international community. So in the 1950s and 60s, Japanese policymakers could not take any of these for granted. So in particular, the existing studies argue that a historical important factor to understand Japan's post-war economic miracle is the consolidation of U.S.-Japan Security Alliance, a process that began in 1958 and culminated with the signing of a revised security treaty in 1960. And this is because the U.S. as a superpower in need of strong anti-communist allies was both willing and able to provide Japan with such advantages. Okay? Japan still might have developed without them, but it is unlikely that it would have developed so fast. So what we do, so that's the existing argument, but what we do in this paper is to test this claim based on in-depth historical analysis and also a set of available statistical tools. Okay, now let me begin with our historical analysis. Okay, on January 19th, 1960, the US and Japan signed a revised alliance treaty that formally committed US to defend Japan from external aggression. The treaty was a culmination, as I said, of several years of negotiations and policy changes that began in the summer 1957 and accelerated significantly in 1958, which I explain later. But before explaining the events and policies in the late 1950s, let me briefly summarize the initial US-Japan relationship. Okay? Now, in the 1951, the US and Japan signed the first security treaty, okay, which gave the US the right to station American troops in Japan. But this treaty actually did not provide Japan with a formal US security guarantee. And this unequal nature of the treaty, as well as some high-profile incidences in which Japanese citizens were killed by the US military personnel, arose widespread, as many of you perhaps know, widespread Japanese contempt for the US presence and the broader US-Japanese alliance. And by the mid-1950s, American officials feared that US policy was failing to keep Japan on America's side of the Cold War. And indeed, in 1956, the Japanese Prime Minister Hatoyama Ichiro normalized Japanese diplomatic relationship with the Soviet Union and also sought to build new economic connections between Japan and Communist China. And then in January 1957, Ishibashi Tanzan became Prime Minister and declared his intention to normalize Japan's relationship with Communist China. That was obviously another big blow to American hopes for an active and a strong US-Japan alliance. But what happened was, next month, Ishibashi became seriously ill and then was replaced as Prime Minister Kishi Nobusuke. He's a strong anti-communist and strong advocate of close relationship with the United States. By the way, do you know who he is? The grandfather of Shinzo Abe, so the current Prime Minister. So this sudden change in leadership opened up the possibility of a new US-Japan relationship, and both sides took this opportunity for the changes. An important turning point in our argument is Kishi's visit to the United States in June 1957. And he met with Eisenhower and his administration in Washington, D.C. And during this visit, U.S. officials made several important historical concessions and then opened up the possibility of renegotiating the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty. And with the renegotiation was something Japan had first requested in 1955. So long years, but US basically said no, until Kishi's visit in June 1957. So this major shift showed US officials' desire to strengthen the US-Japan relationship by supporting Kishi and Kishi's administration. Now, throughout the negotiations for the revised treaty, which took place mainly between 1959, U.S. negotiators were very responsive to Japan's demands. and they demonstrated their desire to renew Japan's commitment to this important relationship in East Asia. So these changes in U.S.-Japan Security Alliance between 1958 and 1960 had significant ramifications, not just in the security area, but also for Japan's economic prospects and also the business climate. U.S. policymakers believed that U.S.-Japan relationship should encompass not just diplomatic political relationship, but equally more importantly, or equally important economic and business interactions. So for example, foreign loans to Japan doubled in 1958, most of which came from the World Bank and U.S. export-import banks and other private banks in Japan, in the U.S. Policymakers and business leaders also worked to facilitate trade between the United States and Japan in 1958, same year. And the Japanese business leaders established a joint committee on U.S.-Japan trade the same year. And then between 1958 and 1960, American purchases from Japan increased more than 150%, then giving Japan its first trade deficit, trade surplus. Sorry, not deficit, surplus. Now, the final treaty was signed in January 1960, but it should be noted that the alliance consolidation process was far from smooth. Socialist labor unions and anti-base groups and student groups helped organize massive protests. In the face of such a large public outcry, the Kishi resigned after the new security treaty passed through the Diet, and then President Eisenhower canceled his planned trip to Japan to celebrate the signing of the new U.S.-Japan Security Treaty. Despite such turmoil in 1960, the strategic relationship between U.S. and Japan continued, and economic interactions was still a main part of this U.S.-Japan alliance. So by the end of 1960s, however, American leaders facing a costly war in Vietnam, okay, an expanding trade deficit, okay, and also low economic growth, became less tolerant of Japan's privileged position in the U.S.-Japan. U.S. economic and security policy. And perhaps not coincidentally, Japan's annual economic growth rate plunged from 10% during the 1960s to 3% in 1971, and then the low economic growth remained until 1980s. Then it declined still further. So what more specifically did U.S. Do for Japan from the late 1950s to the 1960s. Okay, first, with regard to investment, I have already briefly mentioned, but let me explain a little bit more. The consolidation of U.S.-Japan alliance allowed Japan to minimize expenditures for its own defense spending. This is widely known. But more specifically, the Eisenhower administration approved lower targets of Japan's defense spending. And because of this, Japan's defense spending as a share of GDP declined by 20% between 1958, again, and 1960. This is the sharpest shift of the entire post-war era, and then continued to decline further. Became below 1% of GDP by 1970. The Patrick and Robowski in their famous book on Japanese post-war economic growth estimated Japan's economy would have been 30% smaller by 1976 if it had shouldered its own defense burden. Okay? U.S. also injected money directly into Japanese economy. Extensive offshore procurement during the Korean War allowed Japanese companies to accumulate large amounts of capital. And as I have already mentioned, the U.S. also orchestrated low-interest loans for Japan, mainly from the World Bank and also U.S. Export-Import Bank. Second point, the Eisenhower, Kennedy, and the Johnson administration resisted protectionist demands from the U.S. interest groups and opened the U.S. market to Japanese goods. And during Japan's high economic growth years, U.S. absorbed more than 30% of Japan's exports. If you compare the data across countries in many years, this tie, strong relationship between U.S. and Japan during this period is statistically exceptional. Okay. Now, third point, U.S. leaders tolerated Japan's policy to promote inflows of foreign technology, but filter out import and foreign investment that have potential to threaten Japanese firms' domestic market share. Okay. In fact, the U.S. transferred advanced technology and know-how to Japan, accounting for more than half of the patents imported by Japanese companies in the 1950s and 60s. And we found that this technological transfer was not just in the major companies like Toyota or some other companies, but throughout in many different areas, and including small, medium-sized, and large companies. The fourth point, U.S. helped support a conservative, business-friendly coalition at the heart of Japan's developmental state. Research by leading scholars and journalists suggest that covert U.S. Funding for LDP members was sort of a routine in the late 1950s and throughout the 1960s. So in sum, there are strong historical reasons for us to believe that the consolidation of the U.S.-Japan alliance, which started in 1958, played a major role in enabling Japan's economic miracle boom from the late 1950s. Okay. Then, now we test our argument using statistical data. I understand that not all of you are familiar with statistical methods. Some of you may just hate statistical methods. So I tried to minimize our technical explanations, but I hope you understand what we do. Okay, and I show the results using some graphs. Okay, so some existing studies have already suggested the consolidation of U.S.-Japan security relationship boosted Japan's post-war economic growth. But to the best of our knowledge, no one has tested it using some statistical data. Okay? So to make causal inference based on the recent literature on causal inference, we need to ask a counterfactual question. Okay? That is, what would Japan's economy have looked like without the consolidation of the U.S.-Japan alliance? Okay? This is actually a challenging question to answer. Okay? Because in order to make a proper causal inference, you need to have a comparative unit or control unit. Okay? But there is no country in the world that is sufficiently similar to Japan, but didn't have security consolidation with the United States in the late 1950s. Okay, so to address this methodological problem, we first use a relatively simple and widely used statistical method called the difference-in-difference regression. We then apply a relatively new non-parametric approach called the synthetic control method. And then we also use an econometric method to estimate so-called structural breaks. Okay. And the data we use for all of these analyses is a well-known historical data set compiled by Angus Madison. Now, before explaining those methods and results, two important remarks are in order. Okay. First, U.S. and Japan formally signed a revised Treaty of Mutual Cooperation and Security on January 1960. But we argue that the groundwork for this strengthened U.S.-Japan relationship was laid in 1958. So in our analysis, we use 1958 as the as methodological term treatment year rather than 1960, and assume that the structural break happened in 1959. So change in 1958, and then policy change and outcome change from in the 1959. Second, strictly speaking, this is an important point. Our statistical analysis allow us to test whether something happened in 1958 set Japan on a high growth trajectory. Okay? This finding itself does not necessarily confirm the existence of a strong causal relationship between the consolidation of U.S.-Japan alliance and Japan's economic miracle. But as I have discussed, our historical analysis suggests that the new security relationship fundamentally changed Japan's economic prospects and business climate. So we argue that this is most likely cause of Japan's growth acceleration. Now, the first method, difference in difference regression. Okay. This is also called fixed effect regression, and it's also a sophisticated version of what is known as an interruptive time series analysis. So the data we use are GDP per capita, the most commonly used indicator of economic growth, of 50 countries. Yeah? Period of investigation is 10 years before and 10 years after 1958, a year we consider as a critical year for Japan's growth acceleration. Okay? And the variables we use are country fixed effects, which control all country-specific but time-invariant observable and unobservable characteristics, year fixed effects, which control all year-specific but country-invariant observable and unobservable characteristics, and a country-specific linear trend, meaning that each country had unique historical path, I mean, trend of growth, economic growth. So we also assume that. Right? So we also, this first one controls all historical, institutional, country-specific factors. Everything is controlled. Any macro global economic shocks, that is also controlled. Country-specific trend is also controlled. But we also add one more variable, which is Japan-specific post-1958 trend variable. Okay. So if these three, first three set of variables sufficiently explain Japan's economic growth, we don't expect last variable to be statistically significant. Okay? But what we found is very significant, and then I don't want to show the regression tables, which are often confusing, so show the result using figure. Okay? So the result of estimation is this. The dots are observed GDP per capita, and a solid line is an old regression predicted line. Okay? Vertical lines show the 95% confidence interval of prediction. And this figure suggests that the model fits very well with the observed data. And a dotted line, that's key, indicates a counterfactual scenario, which is drawn by assuming that the coefficient for the Japan-specific post-1958 trend variable is zero. There is no Japan-specific trend. Okay, if you assume that Japan's economic path was the dotted line. So in another word, the gap is a causal effect of something that happened in 1958. Now, problems, that's a standard method, okay? But the simple method, but there are some limitations. This part is a bit technical, but so maybe you can ignore, but it's for those who are interested in statistical methods, this is the key part, okay? Now, first of all, we only added a post-1958 trend variables for Japan, okay, but not for other countries. So it's not clear whether the post-1958 divergence is unique to Japan. Second, we assume linear trend variables just for simplicity, but we don't know what a proper functional form for the trend variable. And then finally, perhaps most importantly in this analysis, all other countries are equally weighted. Okay? This means that countries similar to Japan's growth path until the end of 1950s and other almost completely dissimilar countries are equally treated to make this counterfactual interpretation. Okay? So to address these issues, we apply a newer method called synthetic control. Okay? This method uses data from multiple comparison units to construct a single synthetic comparison unit, which resembles the unit of interest before it experienced some critical event or treatment. Well, specifically, we construct a synthetic Japan using a weighted average of the country in the so-called donor pool, and then weights are estimated by constraint optimization with a set of so-called predictors, variables that are not influenced by the treatment, but are expected to affect the post-treatment trajectories of Japan's per capita GDP. And as long as the selection of predictors and the length of pre-treatment period is valid, we should obtain a synthetic control that provides a good fit for the treated unit, that is Japan. Okay, so to evaluate the credibility of our result, we also conducted a series of so-called placebo tests in which the treatment is reassigned counterfactually to different years and also different countries. But I don't show this result, but if you're interested in this result, please ask me. I can show some of these results in question Q&A. Okay? Essentially, the results suggest that our analysis is highly credible. Okay? So again, I don't want to show tables, so figure. Okay? So this figure compares the trajectories of per capita GDP between Japan, black line, and a synthetic Japan, gray line. Okay? The two lines are almost identical, exactly the same until 1958, okay? The year of the treatment. But they began to diverge after 1958 and continue to diverge at an even faster rate until the end of the sample period. Okay? By 1968, Japan's actual per capita GDP is $3,277 higher, or almost 70% higher than the synthetic Japan's GDP. From 1958 to 68, the synthetic Japan's per capita GDP grew 4.4% annually. That is high growth, to be sure, but far from economic miracle. By contrast, the economic growth of actual Japan during the same period was 10.35%. Okay? So therefore, our statistical findings suggest that Japan was placed on a faster economic path starting in 1959. But as I mentioned, it is important to note that our quantitative statistical results, strictly speaking, only show when an unexplained acceleration in Japan's growth occurred, rather than why Japan's growth acceleration. So our results could be driven by some other events that occurred in the same year, 1958. Okay, so one such event could be the 1958 Japanese elections in which Liberal Democratic Party, which was formed in 1955, secured more than 60% of the seats in the 1958 lower house elections. And then LDP continued to retain power until 1993. But we're skeptical that it fully explains our results. The 1958 election, LDP indeed won. And if we go back to the history, we know that after 1958 until 1993, LDP continued to win, okay? But 1958 election itself was not a landslide victory, okay? So it was so hard to think that Japanese investors became very aggressive after observing 1958 election, and then they predicted that LDP would dominate Japanese politics for 35 years. Such prediction as of 1958 is, I don't think that makes sense. The second alternative explanation for our statistical results is Japan's business cycle. Okay? Specifically, Iwato boom started in 1958. Okay. But such an interpretation focusing on the business cycle may explain the initial few years of economic growth after 1958. Okay. but it seems an unlikely explanation for the next decade of double-digit growth rate. And also, moreover, as I explained, the surge of Japanese investment in investment rate beginning in 1958 was, we argue, partially endogenous to Japan's relationship to the United States. So we acknowledge that there may be some other factors that explain Japan's growth acceleration in 1958, but we believe that these factors cannot sufficiently explain Japan's sustained growth, exceptionally high economic growth, in the years after 1958. And these alternative interpretations factors may be at least partially endogenous to Japan's relationship with the U.S. Endogenous is a bit technical term, but it means that those domestic factors were in part connected to the U.S.-Japan relationship. If you think about Japanese domestic economy, domestic policy, economic policies in the 1950s, so many of them are connected to the U.S. intentions and U.S. strategic policies. That's what we argue. It's very hard to think some important policy change or institutional change that happened in Japan which are completely independent of the U.S. intention, U.S. policy in East Asia. Now, maybe 10 more minutes. That is the last statistical part, which is not in the paper, by the way. This is relatively new addition to our study. I would like to show some evidence that it was 1958 rather than other years in which Japan's growth acceleration started. So the method to test the structural change in time series data was first proposed by Gregory Cho in his well-known paper published in 1960. If you have studied econometrics or economics, this is one of the most widely read papers. Okay? His method is simple, but very useful to test whether there was a structural change in time series analysis if the timing of historical change is known. Okay? But if the timing of structural change is unknown, then alternative test called QLR test has been used in the literature, particularly in the literature of economics and economic history. Now, there are so many studies in the last 40 almost 50 years, but one example, famous example, is a paper estimating turning points in the Civil War using the same method, published 1996 in American Economic Review. Okay, my only equation in this presentation. Okay, just in case you are interested in statistics, so we apply this method. Okay, historical. We use the same historical data, 1920 to 2000, and what we do is for each year. For each potential year of structural break, we estimated this statistical model. Okay, independent variables is a change in GDP per capita from the previous year. No, sorry, dependent variable is a change in GDP per capita from the previous year. Indicator variable I is a dichotomous variable, which is one for all years after year K and zero otherwise. But the model also includes four lags, assuming that any change in GDP per capita is serially correlated. Okay, and the difference in GDP per capita between this year and last year is expected to fluctuate over time, as you can easily imagine. Okay, but if there is a structural change happened in a certain year, it still fluctuates. Okay, but the average is different. Okay, so average before certain year is this, fluctuate, but if there is a structural change, average change goes down or goes up and then fluctuate. So estimate this change in the average. That's what, you know, this B times I variable indicates. Okay, so but specifically for we have 1920 to 2000 data, but following the literature, we use the inner 70% of the sample, so excluding the first and the last 15%, And then for each possible breakpoint year from 1939 to 1989, we estimated this regression model and computed what is known as the Chow F test. And then maximum Chow statistic is called the QLR statistics. That's the end. The result, okay, result I think is intuitive and you can understand. So it shows basically the same thing. Okay, the Chow F statistic is the largest in 1958. Okay, and so the indicator variable to test the structure break does not include, in my specification, does not include that particular year. So the, this actually result suggests that something happened in 1958, and then speed of Japan's economic growth changed from a year after. Okay, this result is consistent with our historical analysis. So conclusion. The question we examine in this paper is, again, why did Japan develop so rapidly? Okay. Most analysis attribute Japan's post-war prosperity to Japan's institutions and policies. But our study, by contrast, suggests that such domestic factors were necessary, but perhaps not sufficient. Japan grew in part because it has good institutions and policies, but more so because it enjoyed exceptional international circumstances. Specifically, Japan had the good fortune to rebuild its economy during the Cold War, when the most powerful country in the world, United States, needed strong allies. The U.S. not only absorbed Japan's exports and tolerated Japan's protectionism, but also subsidized the Japanese economy and transferred technology to Japanese firms. So, without such advantages, Japan might still have achieved solid economic growth, but probably not an economic miracle. Thank you very much.